Good afternoon and welcome to my home in Mattaquette. And today we'll continue our passion for people conversations with some of Nantucket's most fascinating people. People who have a passion for what they do and a passion for this island. Today I have the privilege to welcome John Shea, actor, director, writer, and producer. His bio reads like a history of theater and movies. From Shakespeare to Superman, he's known Sidney Lumet, Joseph Papp. He's been with Helen Mirren, Sarah Fawcett, Meryl Streep recently. John, you go back and forth between L.A. and Nantucket. How do you do it? How do you balance your lifestyle with your career and your family?
Well, first of all, I'm really happy to be here in your home. And you and I have known each other for a long time. This is the first time we've ever had an interview with each other, so I'm really, really happy to answer anything you want to know. So look, I sort of do it the way you do it, the way everybody does it. We do it out of passion, we do it out of love. And so at the moment, yes, I live on Nantucket. I live here with my wife, Melissa, and our kids. They go to school here. We live in Sconset. And this is where I live. And I live here because I love it here. And all my friends are here. And I feel that I'm spiritually connected to the island in profound ways and have been ever since I first landed here. And so I can't think of any other place where I'd rather live. But unfortunately, I can't always work here, which means that my whole life, I've been a little bit like a Nantucket whaler. I've had to go offshore to hunt for work and then bring it back and put food on the table. So at the moment, I'm hunting in Los Angeles. What I do is that I'm pretty good at it. I've been doing it for, I don't know, on and off for many, many years, either from New York or Nantucket, for 30 years, 40 years. And what I do is that I get up early in the morning in Los Angeles, and I get on the first flight out, 5 o'clock, 6 o'clock, 7 o'clock flight. I come into Boston. I take a bus down to Hyannis. I take the ferry over from Hyannis. I usually take the fast ferry if I can, but if it's not running, the slow boat. And then I just enjoy the ride across, and I get here by dinner time, and I see Melissa and the kids, and that's how
you
I
make
do
it sound smooth as silk, John, and we know it's not. We know what Nantucket can deliver in weather. Do you have any travel tips? You seem to be able to breeze through your travel.
You know, I don't really think ever about the travel. I never think about the weather. I just kind of go with the flow, because I don't have time to even look ahead. I just kind of go with the flow, Beverly, and it always works out. Never missed a flight. Never missed a boat. Maybe once in a while, yes, the boats are canceled, and I spend the night in Hyannis, but that's the worst, right? And then get up in the morning and take the next boat over. So it's really no problem, and well, it's worth it.
Obviously, it's worth it to come home to your family and come home to this wonderful island.
Yeah.
I think it's legendary how you found Nantucket or how you started your career here with Mack Dixon in 1968, was it?
In 1968,
just wandered into Straight Wharf Theater.
I did. I stepped off the boat. I checked into this little rooming house where I was. I went over to Cy's Green Coffee Pot to get something to eat. And Milton Zlotnick, who ran it, put an apron on me and put me in the kitchen and said, "Wash these dishes. I'll give you a free dinner." And after I finished washing up the dishes, I said, "Where could I get a drink?" And he said, "Well, go down at the end of Straight Wharf. There's big Captain Toby's." And I stumbled in to the Straight Wharf Theater, and I looked, and on the stage there was a play going on, and this woman in the back row said, "What are you doing here?" And I said, "Well, I did my first play at school, and I want to see what's going on." And she said, "Well, you should meet Mac." And she said, "Mac?" And Mack Dixon, the founder of the theater workshop, came over to me, and he said, "Shay," he said, "can you do an Irish accent?" And I said, "Well, you know, I could learn one." He said, "Good answer. Here, take the script and go backstage. You were about to make your first entrance." I said, "What?" And it turns out that I had stumbled into the final dress rehearsal of a play by Sean O'Casey called Juno and the Paycock. Next thing I knew, I was on the stage, and then I opened the play the next night. It was the final dress rehearsal, and they were a man short. And that's the way things happened miraculously on the island for me ever since. There was a kind of kismet to everything.
Serendipity.
You know, you've experienced this.
That's how I came.
Okay.
As you know, I came quite by accident. I was headed for Martha's Vineyard, where my brother was working at Menemsha Inn, and I got the wrong boat, or at least I got the boat that didn't stop on Nantucket. So I ended up in Nantucket, never left, walked into the house, still living here 53 years later.
You came into this house?
I came into this house, not as it is now,
yes, of
but
course
this
not.
House.
Yep.
Oh. And you and I, we share a lot about Nantucket. But speaking of bicoastal, you're in Sconset, I'm in Mattigan, and sometimes never the twain meet. However, I've followed your career, as you have been a part of mine. And I wonder if you remember this picture I took of you back in 1988, which was the interview for the Map and Legend, before so much of your life has unfolded.
And, Beverly, but I think you photographed me before that.
I probably did.
Early one, maybe from the 70s. That
I wish I could have found that picture, but maybe I can find it.
I was honored to be in your show that they had at the Quaker Meeting House at the museum back there.
That is actually the reason for this continuation.
Oh, great.
Because I believe that the people who I photographed then, their backstory was not shown except for their photographs.
Yeah.
So the interviews have come out of that desire.
Great.
To write more about these people before we lose this wonderful oral history.
Yeah, great, great.
Now, speaking of that Irish accent, there was a little comment in one of the bios about you, but Martin Scorsese said, you will never be able to play in Italian. What do you think about that? Well, and you created Southie out of that comment.
Martin Scorsese was casting Goodfellas, and I love Martin Scorsese's work, and I wanted to work with him, and he said, John, you're never going to be in any of my films, you're not Italian. He said, the Irish are supposed to be such good storytellers, go tell your own stories. There hasn't been a good Irish-American filmmaker since John Ford. And he got me thinking, and a couple years later, I came across a story of a Franciscan friar called Daniel Egan, who was living in New York, who was fighting the mob and trying to save women from dying in the streets from heroin overdoses in the late 50s. Anyway, I started writing his story, and that led to Southie, and that's led to all my directing. So I have to thank Martin Scorsese. Mm-hmm. But what I've tried to do is to mine that Irish heartbeat that exists not only in Nantucket, but in Boston and New York and other places, yeah.
Well, I watched a little bit of Southie the other night. I could get it. And it made me think about why I don't watch too many movies these days. And I got to ask you, because I have a fear of violence. Mm-hmm. And I think there's too much violence in our films these days. Mm-hmm. How do you respond to that idea or that concern?
Well, part of the themes that go through my film, and I have to say my theater work and my work in general, is how we respond to violence and what causes violence. Beverly, I think I discovered that in my life that violence comes from anger. And then the question is, everybody gets angry, but what do we do about that anger? Mm-hmm. I mean, what if, and when it goes past anger, it turns into rage. And I'm talking about the collective rage of a nation after 9/11, when the World Trade Center came down. We had a massive national collective rage, and we wanted to vent that rage and go destroy Saddam Hussein and Iraq and the rest of it, right? We get stung by the bee, and we want to destroy the beehive. So I'm concerned with the subject of violence, and what is the proper approach to dealing with violence, and what is the price we pay when we choose violence as our answer to violence that happens to us. So Southie is about a guy who's, you know, in a lot of pain and is seeking revenge, and Grey Lady also has similar themes, and the junkie priest is caught up in violence. And I have to say, I don't think of myself as a violent person, but I find myself surrounded in the world of violence.
Great answer. That helps me see a few more films now, and so I won't be as afraid of it as I was. Well, I was going to save this for the end, but since you mentioned Grey Lady, I notice it's coming out in March, which is just a month away. Can you tell us a little bit about your excitement at this premiere of your film?
Well, the reason why I've been commuting recently back and forth to California is because it is opening. Not in March. Lionsgate, who's now acquired the rights, has asked us to push it to April, so we have another month to prepare, which is really good. But look, Grey Lady was a massive, massive work on my part. And I've dedicated 10 years of my life to it, and it's finally, you know, like a boat that you hand make, and you surround many friends, and they're all part of it as well. And now it's about to be launched. But look, Grey Lady came about from a walk that I took with a great friend of mine here on the island, Armie Bernstein, right, who was my producing partner on this film. And Armie Bernstein had directed me in a film years ago in Warner Brothers that he wrote. And so he said, we should work together again. And I said, what do you want to do? And he said, well, let's do a thriller and set it in a resort in the off season. And I said, okay, what about here? He said, yeah, exactly. There's never been a major feature film shot on Nantucket. Let's try to set one here. And I said, well, what's the story? And he said, well, I don't know, you got to make one up. But, you know, it's a thriller. So there's a cop and there's a crime and there's a girl and, you know, it's Nantucket. So it's like spooky, it's off season, it's lonely. And I said, that's it, you know? I wasn't thinking about a thriller. I wanted to do The Junkie Priest, that story in New York. And he said, no, let's see if we can make it so that it has a touch of poetry about the whole thing that allows it to transcend the genre. And I said, okay, so that it's more than a thriller. And he said, yeah. So that thought, a touch of poetry that allows it to transcend, inspired me, transcend the genre. And so it set me to writing, and I wrote for 2 years, and every 6 months or so I would go off to LA and I'd meet with Army and we would, you know, kind of spitball about the story. And then, anyway, I finished the screenplay. And then we raised the money and financed it, and all of our friends on Nantucket came together, like in your projects, you know, how supportive people are. All the investors came from this island. And then many of the people who worked on the film came from the island. The actors came from the island, although I brought them in from all over the world as well. And now that film about a cop who comes here to investigate a crime has been a major work in my life, and I'm very proud of it. And I hope that it captures a little bit of the spirit of Nantucket. Because while it's about a guy who's trying to solve a crime, it's about how the island helps him solve an even deeper mystery about who he really is and why things are the way they are.
I can't wait to see it. I'm very excited about it. I've heard a lot of hype. But there's one part of it I heard that perhaps the woman in it was based on your wife, Melissa, who's an artist and painter.
You know, Beverly.
And I do adore your wife, Melissa. She actually spent some time in my little cottage next door before she met you.
I know, she loves you
and
too.
And there's a nice little story there.
You've always been really kind to her. So yeah, at a certain point.
We have one of her paintings here too.
Well, she loves you too. So I'll say that, yes, you know, when you bring a Boston homicide detective to Nantucket, you're like, who would be the least likely person that he would meet? And I thought he would, but maybe the most important person for him to meet would be an artist. Because I believe that the artists on this island are a breed apart, and they carry a kind of spiritual message in all of their work. And I thought it was the kind of thing that our hero, a rational thinking cop filled with rage and bent on revenge, would need to hear. And so, you know, in the course of the story, he does come across a painter very much modeled after Melissa McLeod, who I called Melissa in the film and played by Natalie Zee so beautifully. But anyway, that's part of the story that I'm really happy about. So I was able to weave in a lot of truth of what I know about the art world here on the island. And, you know, that Melissa and her friends, Kasha Baker and Robert McKee and Sanchez Oman and all those great artists started the X Gallery. And so we created the X Gallery in the film. And all I can tell you is that it's a little bit of magic that I'm really happy to have brought back to life.
Well, the island has been such a canvas to all that you've done. And you've also brought poetry and spirituality into it. And, of course, the Irish are known for their poetry and spirituality as well. Not just the Junkie Priest, but other parts of those Irish ways. Can you tell us a little bit about how poetry and spirituality inform your daily life?
You know, I grew up with a mother and a father. Father who was Irish, mother who was French and German, but both of whom loved poetry. My mother particularly gave me poems to read as a child and taught me, you know, gave me painting lessons, and I played the piano. I learned how to compose music. So my childhood was filled with art. My father was an all-American football player and a scientist and a kind of educator and a rationalist. So there was a nice combination of yin and yang. And poetry early on for me was Shakespeare. And Shakespeare, I think, is the greatest poet. But certainly I was drawn to all of the romantic poets, to Wordsworth and to Coleridge and Shelley and to Yeats and Keats, and I love their poems. When I went to Bates College up in Maine, I was editor of the literary magazine, and I got to know all the poets on the island, and I mean on the campus. And then when I came to Nantucket, I got to meet the poets and the writers here, and I loved Frank Conroy, and I got to know Russell Baker and David Halberstam, and you know all the
wonderful
great writers that we've had here.
I wish they were all here right now.
Well,
they all feel like they're here.
Their books are here, Beverly.
Their books are here. I have photographed them all.
Well, and you've always been, you know, like had this sense of salon and you know, or as a gathering place for artists on the island. And I think artists have a special responsibility. We have a special gift, but a special responsibility to use our intuition, use whatever talents God gave us, to try to tell a deeper truth about mm-hmm. life, you know, beyond politics and beyond, you know, the temporary things. What are the eternal truths? And how can we express them in our work? And we try to do this, right? We try to do it at the theater workshop in the plays that we choose. Mm-hmm. We try to do it in the films that we make. We try to do it in the photographs that we take.
Well, speaking of the films and the theater, what do you see as the future of the theater in Nantucket? There are new theaters and there are transformed theaters. I mean, the TWN has gone through a number of transformations. We have White Heron and...
The theater Beverly, you know, the theater on Nantucket has always been vibrant. I mean, really, you know, after our founding by the Puritans and the Quakers, the theater was banned here. I think the first actors showed up from Boston in the early 1700s, and there was they had to sort of come to a private home and put on a private performance because theater was not allowed on the island, right? But and it was scandalous and exciting, and people loved it, and so these actors came back. But by the end of the 19th century, the 1800s, the actors' colony was born out of Sconset. And one of the reasons why I live in Sconset is because mm-hmm. I always feel kin to that whole history. Days when Eugene O'Neill was coming to Sconset to lecture on plays, and Isadora Duncan was dancing in what's now the Summer House. You know, the actors' colony was in full bloom. And then it migrated into town. That turned into the theater workshop and then Mac Dixon. And then that was the only theater around for many years. But then there were splinter theaters. There was the actors' theater. And now there's White Heron, which is a splinter of the theater workshop group, right? So it's just the way water flows. Water flows until it finds a way to go this way and that way. But it's all the same water. And we're all doing the same, we're on the same mission, which is to tell stories and try to inspire, enlighten, and entertain our audiences.
Well, as an aspiring new actor, my new career in front of the camera instead of behind it, what are some of your advices to those who have stage fright or those legendary butterflies? How would you tell that fledgling actor how to handle those situations?
Well, look, I would give them the same advice that people gave me, which is to take a deep breath. Breath is the secret to everything. I remember being backstage, you know, before I would go out onto a play, you know, on Broadway, let's say. I would be in the wings and there'd be, you know, 2,000 people or in the West End in London or even in the smallest off-Broadway house, and I would always get nervous, and I still get nervous. And so what I do is that I do what my teachers at school taught me, which is to breathe really deeply. It's that yoga breathing, right? In mm-hmm. through the mouth and out, and then three times, and then sort of drop over into it like this, you know? And then slowly come all the way up and then fall over again, you know. And what happens is that as you oxygenate your mind and your body, everything, you just can't help but relax.
Well, John, you're making me so relaxed. I better stay focused. But exercises like that are very important. I'm aware of that. But there is still something that people say you have to have those butterflies and that stage fright that gives you the edge that puts you on. And you have been on almost all of your 69 years, it seems to me. And we'll talk about your birthday in a minute because I'm a birthday girl.
I'm 68. I'm
68. Well, yeah. By the way, in your bios, they've mentioned 1949 and 1948 twice, April 14th.
Yeah.
And now I've discovered that it is 1948. And I'm wondering what you feel about your legacy. I know that you get to a decade and you start looking back and you think, what's my legacy? You have two beautiful children who are interested in the theater.
Well, I have a boy, Jake, from my
Jake,
first...
And Jake, who I photographed many, many years ago.
Who's in New York and happily married and doing really well, and I love him, and he's great, and I'm proud of him. And certainly Miranda and Caden, my two young children. They're sort of really important to be able to, you know, pass on that sort of teaching. Look, my father, as I said, was a teacher, and my father's whole mission in life was to discover whatever talent lay inherent in any given child and to foster that talent so that the child could then express it and make the world a better place. And it was a kind of Greek concept of body, mind, and spirit, right? So a strong body, with a educated mind, but with a vibrant, resilient spirit, And by that I mean a spirit that, you know, is connected both to the earth and to the heavens, right? So understands, you know, the big kind of metaphysical questions and wrestles with them. Look, the other, I just want to go back to acting just for a second, because I was classically trained for a long time. And what I still do, and I believe, Beverly, if you're really asking me what I think you should do, is to really prepare backstage or off stage before you go on. I spend an hour before I go on stage, every night, every performance, wherever I am in the world, doing vocal exercises, doing yoga. And I say things like articulation exercises, like, give me the gift of a grip top sock, a clip drape ship shape tip top sock. Not your spiv slip slapstick slip slop sock of a slapdash flash gash haberdash shop. Give me the gift of a grip top sock. And I bite the words, and you know, so if you do that and you get yourself into a kind of meditative trance, like a zone, when you're backstage, when you, by the time you go on stage, you're warmed up. You're like, you know, like baseball players, you know, they spend an hour having batting practice, all that stuff that we never see. We just turn on the game or go to the stadium. And that's, but really, all the pros warm up. And I would just say, warm up.
Warm up.
Yeah.
Well, if you were around a little bit longer, John, I'd ask you to be my coach. I'm not sure I could get through that tip-top stuff, but I think that's a good exercise.
I'd be happy to do it with you.
And the breathing, of course, is extremely
really important. And stretching, yoga, all those things.
Stretching and yoga.
Yeah. Yeah.
Well, at 75, I'm finding some of those stretches a little bit harder to do.
You do it,
as I
you
age.
Can do, but without pain.
Okay, well, I take something for that pain. I know that in the theater, there are always times when you feel like you just haven't done it right, or you haven't done what you had hoped to do, and that goes in with the butterflies and the tension.
Yeah.
But how have you learned by your failures? And can you give us an example of something that taught you a lesson that helped you be even better?
Okay, well, let me just say that the beauty of the theater is that it's like sculpture, that every night you are chiseling away at it, trying to achieve an ideal performance. Mm-hmm. And the beauty of having 1 month is that every night is another, you know, opportunity to get it right. Because the playwrights give us the text, the dialogue in the text, what we do as actors is that we create the subtext, the thoughts that link each of the lines that the playwright has given us together. So, because thought is, by definition, infinite, and you can have a lot of different thoughts between different parts of text, you know, I've done plays that last for a week and plays that last for a year. And the question is, why would you do a play for 6 months or, you know, 8 months or something, as I've done several times? And the answer is because you're always striving for the perfect performance. And you have, by definition, failed every night. And therefore, you need to keep making it better. And you keep making it better by working on your lines, constantly going back to the script, and thinking more thoughts on stage in the moment. And so that's really fun about the theater. Movies are the opposite. Movies are like oil painting, right? So you have, you know, 10 or 15 takes sometimes, maybe two or three, but it happens much more spontaneously. And television is more like watercolor, where it just, you get one or two takes and you're done. And so you're much more quick, you know, impulsive, spontaneous kind of acting, where you don't do much rehearsing, you just kind of throw it out there.
Well, I have learned so much from you, and I've had so many experiences just listening to you that I feel like I am transported by your metaphors and your analogies, as well as your energy, your life force, which for me, and I think for anyone who talks to other people, is what the essence of what we share with each other, who we are, that life force, that energy that makes us the people that we are.
Yeah.
That's our essence. This is why I feel your passion every time I talk to you, look at your pictures, and I've asked you to think about your life message, but I think in a way you've sort of said what you feel about what your legacy and your message is. It is said that my life is my message, and you're a living proof of it sitting here. And I would just say, how do you keep perpetuating that message in face of some of the things that are going? We talked about anger, we talked about violence, And it really is a world that has changed so much. And our children are going into a whole new world now, not only through technology, but other things that are happening that we, and our imaginations are being compromised.
Beverly, I saw you in the Short Film Festival, and I saw how you were, I would think, intuitively attracted to the Monahan
Anna
sisters,
Monahan.
Particularly those great ladies at mm-hmm. Greater Light. And you know that they were, you know, kindred spirits to you.
Definitely.
And that is that they were creative entities that wanted to share their experience with the world and make the world a better place, whether it's by transforming a house the way you've transformed this place, and then sharing whatever you can with the world. And so I know you understand what I mean when I say that that's what drives me. I feel like, but I need guidance, and my life is far from perfect. I went through an extremely painful divorce, and so that I had to come to understand why things like that happen in life. And I've had to seek the truth. I've lost a lot of friends to death. I lost a great friend today. On my way here, I discovered it, you know. So I was a little late talking to his children. Anyway, a really good friend who I spent a lot of time on Nantucket with in New York. And so, but I no longer feel sad about death. I'm going to miss this guy. But I have a clear philosophy. That is a cosmology that the adversity that we have experienced in life has forced me to sort of come to grips with. Like, and what do the Buddhists teach? Mm. What do the Hindus teach? What do the Jews teach? What do the Christians teach? What do the Native Americans teach? What do the Egyptians, you know, what do all of the great philosophies from Plato to Socrates to Kierkegaard to, you know, some guy who's teaching at, you know, whatever, UMass, what is the common thought that everybody has about life? And what are our, you know, and I pursue those truths and I try to reflect them in the work that I do. And I try to teach them to my children and I try to live a life that kind of, that I'm not always successful, but I think, isn't that our mission, right? Isn't that our mission? And I feel like we're on a mission and there's no time to really have fear or be faint of heart. You just have to keep going forward. And then when you leave this body behind, you still are going marching forward, right?
Yes, right, John. There is so much to digest in all that you said.
No, I don't know. I think of Shakespeare and the Tempest.
I think of Shakespeare and the Tempest, and I think that you had hoped to make the Tempest a part of Nantucket's theater experience here. Starting at the Bosun's Locker, I remember that?
Bosun's Locker, Beverly.
Then we go back, way back.
Oh, my God.
But maybe on that note, we should think of something in the future, now that Grey Lady has been launched.
Yeah.
Is the Tempest a possibility?
You know, before I die, I would like to do the Tempest on this island again, the way I maybe originally conceived of it, but even if we do it at the theater workshop, and, you know, but look, the Tempest is a great play, Shakespeare's last play, set on an island, mm-hmm. and, you know... you know, other people can have their crack at it, and one day, hopefully, I'll get a crack at it. I've written a sequel to Grey Lady already. It is not set on the island, and it's set someplace else. It takes our hero, who is a kind of spiritual warrior, on another kind of quest. I've written a pilot and several episodes of a television series that is set on Nantucket. There's no violence in it at this point, Beverly, you'll be happy to know. But it's more of a romantic comedy. There's a lot of music in it, and it's been really fun to write. And maybe if I get lucky, one day I'll get to shoot it here on the island. I'm excited about doing Moby Dick again. You know, I do it every year, but I have for the last 4 or 5 years, and I love playing Ahab, and I love that story and its message, you know, about the nature of revenge. This is a man who's filled with fury, is bent on it, right, and the price he pays for it all. That's the future for me, is kind of more of the same.
Well, I think your message of making the world a better place, keeping that passion for life, that passion for the arts, and your incredible energy are going to perpetuate whatever dream you have next. And hopefully, I know your children will follow that too, because I've watched them on stage, and they seem to be coming in with that Shea energy. So I want to thank you so much. I have learned more than I ever expected to learn. I thought I knew enough about you, which I've put in this little notebook here. And now I'm going to ask for your autograph before this program is over.
I want yours. I'll trade you, only if you trade.
No, I have my passion for people. But I want to thank everybody for coming back and listening to my conversation with John Shea and for being a part of this new series called Passion for People. And I want you to stay tuned and join me next week for another exciting and fascinating Nantucket Notable. Thank you.
Thank you, Beverly.
And thank you, John Shea.
No, thank you, Beverly Hall. Thank you.